By the fall of 1983, Barry Beach was back in Montana from Louisiana to stand trial for the murder of Kim Meese, a trial many thought to be a mere formality. All those whispers, the rumors about girls from the town of Poplar being the real killers must have been wrong. After all, Barry Beach had confessed to her murder. What more was there to say? Well, actually, quite a bit.
Weren't exactly a choir boy, were you?
No, sir.
This is Barry Beach.
I was your very typical small-town teen. I drove fast cars. I liked rock and roll. I drank.
To excess occasionally.
To excess quite often.
Smoked a joint once in a while?
Yes, sir. I was used dope.
And you liked to party?
Every chance I got, to be honest with you.
In fact, by the time he was 18, Beach had two DUIs and had spent close to a month in jail for traffic offenses. And on the day of the murder, in June 1979, Barry says, he was doing the usual, drinking too much, smoking some dope, swimming in the Poplar River outside town, when his car broke down.
I was mad at my car. I actually ended up hitting my vehicle several times in the door. I banged my fist on the windshield. I vented my anger.
Forced then to walk the mile back into town, Beach says, with a good buzz on and no one at home when he finally arrived. His bed looked awfully inviting.
I actually just went straight to my bedroom and went to sleep.
What time was this?
That was somewhere between 5 and 6 o'clock in the evening.
And Barry Beach says that's where he stayed the night Kim Meese was killed, in bed. But what about that detailed confession he gave to detectives in Louisiana? He says something quite different there. Well, that's where it gets interesting. Beach doesn't deny that he confessed to the killing. Far from it.
You said you killed that girl up in Montana.
Yes, sir. I said that on tape that I killed Kim Meese.
And that's when the story enters the twilight zone. Barry Beach says he believed he was about to be released from prison, those minor charges called in by his stepmother about to be dropped, when suddenly he found himself in an interrogation room answering questions about murder. Those detectives seemed to think he had committed those three unsolved Louisiana murders, the murders they were trying so very hard to solve.
The next thing I know, they got very accusatory and started not only telling me that I knew these girls, but that I had killed them. And then they started showing me pictures of dead bodies and told me, remember doing this. And I'd say, I was telling them I didn't do it. I didn't kill anyone.
And as the day wore on, Beach claims, it was Commander Alfred Calhoun who ratcheted up the pressure.
He promised me that he would personally see me fry in the Louisiana electric chair. And then he spent half an hour to an hour explaining to me the different effects of a person when they are electrocuted, all the way from their hair being singed and catching on fire, how it affects your heart when the electricity hits your body.
What were you feeling in the middle of all this?
I was scared to death, Keith, but I knew that he would convict me. He would execute me if given the chance.
Then, says Beach, the talk turned to that murder in Montana, the murder of Kim Meese.
You were asked to speculate about how she may have been killed.
Yes, sir. Well, it started off that they asked me to speculate how it happened, and then I was asked to give a hypothetical story using myself as the perpetrator.
By that time, says Beach, he was terrified, would say just about anything to get out of there. He says he remembers his interrogator telling him he could work to prove his innocence later back in Montana, if he just confessed now. And so, those memory is rather fuzzy. That, he says, is what he did.
You remember any of what you said?
I don't deny that the confession took place. I don't remember all the details.
But Barry, come on. I really don't think I'm going to tell a police officer I killed a girl if I didn't kill her.
That is hard for most people in America to believe that a person could be led to confess to a crime they did not commit.
Well, why would you do it?
I was a 20-year-old kid, 2,300 miles away from my real home. They scared me so bad, I would have said anything to get away from them.
Just to make it stop.
Anything to make it stop.
And so, Barry Beach now says he confessed to a crime he did not commit. But in 1984, as authorities in Montana prepared to put Beach on trial for murder, there were complications. That tape-recorded confession of Barry Beach's, somehow, it was gone.
I went to pull the tapes out of evidence, and the custodian of the records said that he had erased the tapes, and we went ballistic, because this was a murder investigation.
But detectives breathed a sigh of relief. J. Vi himself had made a transcript of the confession. So when the trial began at the courthouse in Glasgow, Montana, there'd be no confession on tape to play for the jurors. They'd read J. Vi's transcript instead. Still, the prosecutor was confident.
I had a detailed confession that only the killer could have given.
Within a decade, Mark Roscoe would be elected Montana's governor. But in 1984, he was an assistant Montana attorney general, called in to prosecute Barry Beach.
He gave a very detailed confession that matched the things that were discovered at the crime scene, from the two different murder weapons to what he did with the body, why the blood spots were located where they were, by the truck and down by the river, on and on and on.
As the trial wore on, Barry Beach, sitting at the defendant's table, had a sinking feeling.
What did that feel like? You want to scream at somebody and say, wait a minute, you're wrong, and you can't. The only thing you can do is sit there and do as your attorney tells you to do. But man, I wanted to jump up and tell them they were wrong.
When testimony was finished, the jury was back in just 6 hours. The verdict? Guilty. For Barry Beach's mother, it was devastating.
Do you remember that moment?
Something a person wouldn't ever forget.
The victim's sister, Pam, heard the news from her father.
Yeah, he told me that he would never be able to get out and that it was over, you know. And
you didn't really feel a sense of relief, did you?
Yeah, I did. But then again, it was also pain, you know, like, why? You know, why him? Why?
Why would Barry do that?
Yeah. He was never mean to me, you know. I didn't know of him to be crazy or nothing.
Yet, at sentencing, Barry Beach's life was, for all intents and purposes, finished.
How long is your sentence?
I'm doing 100 years dangerous, no parole, no furlough, hard labor.
In the spring of 1984, Barry Beach entered Montana State Prison as a dead man walking. He'd surely die here, never be eligible for parole, never have a chance. Or would he?
When we come back, strangers become believers that Barry Beach is innocent.
Does anybody care who that bloody palm print belongs to? They're afraid of the truth.
A new look at the evidence when Whispers in a Small Town continues.